A number of issues I want to raise with you today. First of all, I want to start with the floods in Queensland, and I want to express my condolences to the family of the 22-year-old man who was killed during the course of those floods. And also, we continue to hold out hope and prayers for the young girl, 14-year-old girl, who was washed away in the floods, and our thoughts are with her family as well. I have a daughter who's 14 years old, so I can understand the terrible time that family must be going through at the moment. I want to thank all of those who are engaged in the rescue and search work up there in Queensland at the moment. It was quite a deluge, as we know. The floodwaters peaked in Maryborough last night at 10 metres. That's a little less, I understand, than back in 2013, but that's a very serious flood. An evacuation order was put in place for the CBD area. The homes were obviously affected, as was parts of the CBD. There is a evacuation centre that has been established at the Brolga Theatre. There was around 25 people there. The last advice I had on that, Condis plan was activated by the head of emergency management yesterday. What that enables is all the disaster arrangements and requests being facilitated through the Commonwealth, through the Emergency Management Authority. I've directed the Commissioner of the National Recovery and Resilience Agency, who was in Queensland at the time, to be there in that area and to be liaising with officials in Queensland. I want to thank the Queensland Premier. We're in contact yesterday. The capacity of the Queensland Government, and particularly local authorities, and I want to thank the local mayors and local government areas in that region who have been doing an excellent job. They are, of course, used to floods in that part of Australia at this time of year especially, and they've been doing an excellent job, and there's been no request for federal resources to support any response or recovery effort. That is well in hand with those local authorities. But you would have seen this morning that Minister McKenzie has announced that the Commonwealth disaster payments, which are $1,000 for adults and $400 for children, have been activated. You'll be able to get those online or by ringing up by tomorrow at 9 a.m. and get those payments if you're in the Gympie, Bundaberg or Fraser Coast areas, as defined. That is the same area that the Queensland Government has been working on in terms of any DRFA assistance that's necessary. There's also the disaster recovery allowance for those who've had income impacted, which is a payment for up to 13 weeks at the job seeker rate, and that will also be available from tomorrow morning to be able to access that. The weather system, which is now linked to Tropical Cyclone Tiffany, it's currently at a Category 2. It's due to make landfall between Cooktown and the Lockhart River today. So an area that is obviously a lot less populated than the areas that we've seen affected by the floods to date, but nonetheless, I know Queensland authorities will be watching that closely and the Commonwealth will be available to assist. I particularly want to thank, in addition to the Premier, to Lou O'Brien and Keith Pitt, who are our local members in that area, who have been working closely with local authorities, and I've been staying in touch with both of them for the work on the ground, and they have two messages. First of all, if it's flooded, forget it. I cannot stress this enough. This is a season that we're anticipating floods, and wherever they might be, wherever they might strike next, if it is flooded, forget it, please. And the other message is to thank all of those who've worked so hard on the ground to support people, those who are in the evacuation centres as we speak. So we'll continue to monitor those situations. I was here yesterday working through that with Joe Buffani, the head of Emergency Management Australia. On the issues of the virus and Omicron, I'll ask the Chief Medical Officer to speak further to this, as well as the General Frewen. Omicron is a gear change and we have to push through. That's what Omicron is about. We're dealing with serious volumes of cases, but we are not seeing the same impact proportionally from previous variants in terms of the impact on hospitalisations, ICU and ventilated patients. There are 5,097 patients in hospital who have COVID. That does not mean they went to hospital because of COVID. It meant they're in hospital and they have COVID. As we outlined a week or so ago, up to half or thereabouts of those patients who are being admitted are being admitted for other reasons and have COVID. That still means they have to be treated in hospital as a COVID patient. But that is not the reason they went to hospital. We're also seeing that, as the CMO advised us yesterday, in ICU numbers as well. So people who are in ICU haven't gone into ICU because of COVID. They're in ICU for other reasons and they have COVID. So it's important to have that qualification around those numbers. There are 78 patients who are on ventilators, which is well within the capacity. The major stresses on the hospital system relate to workforce issues, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But of course, today, living with COVID means continuing to ensure we press ahead with the vaccination program. And the children's vaccine commences today. We have contracted 3.3 million vaccines. There are over 2 million of those which are already in the country. The balance will be here within a week. There are 2.3 million children in those age groups of 5 to 11. There are 6,000 places where people can go and get those children's vaccines. There are 835,000 vaccines in those places right now as of last Friday, and more would have been added to that since last Friday. So the aim here is to have as many of the places where you can go and get it. So if you can't get it from where you would normally go, no, there are 5,999 and more other places where these vaccines are on the shelves. So there's 835,000 doses on those shelves, in those fridges, in those pharmacies, in those GPs, and in those state hubs right now. And General Frewen can go into more detail about the breakdown of those when he speaks in a moment. 5,100 children have already had, age 5 to 11, that vaccine because they are in those priority categories of a medically required earlier vaccination. I'm also pleased to note that the booster program, around 1.3 million boosters have been delivered and doses administered in the past week. We are now running at 8 times the rate for boosters that we were on the first dose of the vaccine, and now well over 2 times the second dose rate for those boosters. There's 3.65 million boosters that have now been administered around the country, and that rate is accelerating, and we expect it to accelerate more, particularly as the state hubs now come online. As you know, the GPs and pharmacies, they've all been there, they've been carrying that load, particularly over this summer period, getting those boosters done. With those larger state hubs coming back online now and over the next few weeks, we will see those numbers improve even further, and we welcome that. That is something that we've been working closely with the states and territories on through the National Cabinet process. I note also what the New South Wales Premier said this morning. Another reminder, the people who are predominantly in hospital, who have gone there because of COVID, are unvaccinated. If you want to end up in hospital, being unvaccinated against this virus is the most likely way to end up there. So please take availability of those vaccines that are available to all Australians free of charge all around the country. We've also been working, as we were yesterday, on the critical supply chain issue, and the Chief Medical Officer will go into more detail on this, but the Medical Expert Panel, the AHPPC, has endorsed a new set of arrangements that relate to workers in critical supply chains in food processing, food production and distribution, as well as emergency services. Now, as you know, some states have already moved on that. As we're working together on that, I understand the Victorian government will be making further announcements on that today. That paper is now before National Cabinet for endorsement. I was not going to wait until Thursday for that. And after discussions with the Chief Medical Officer, as soon as it was endorsed, we agreed that that should immediately go to National Cabinet for endorsement. I anticipate that will happen over the course of the morning. It was sent to them earlier today, so we'll just wait for their endorsement, and that will enable them to take that up. What that involves is asymptomatic, close contacts being able to go to work in those sectors. But I'll allow the Chief Medical Officer to speak more to that. The next step is to take that further into other critical sectors, and we're especially looking at the transport sector, both in aviation and in other distribution tasks. So not customer facing, I should note, on the food side. So if we're talking about Coles and Woolies, we're not talking about people who are working on checkouts. Anyone who's customer facing, they are not doing that. But those who are driving the trucks to deliver the food, those who are stacking the shelves at night, those who are in the distribution centres, those who are in the abattoirs, those who are in the manufacturing places that are producing food, all of those are now caught up in those new critical supply chain rules, and we're looking to extend those to other sectors. I note some premiers have noted that they'd be keen to look at how we could apply that in the hospitality sector. We'll take that one step at a time, but for now we are very focused through the process being led by Minister Andrews on those critical supply chains and getting the workers where we need them to go. As the case numbers continue to rise, the volume of cases will of course have an inevitable impact on the workforce, and so we're looking to maximise those who can remain in the workforce, and that is why these arrangements are being put in place. But anyone who is symptomatic or has COVID, they are not going into work. And I should note that these arrangements are already in place in the aged care sector. They're already operating there as they are in the healthcare sector. Now, this is an incredibly tough time on business. There aren't lockdowns, but there are many people obviously impacted by being close contacts or people being wary, or those indeed who have COVID themselves. And that is having an impact on consumer spending. That's predictable and understandable, and that will be the case for a while yet, while Omicron works its way through and moves to its peak. But that means it is very tough on business, and so we're working to ensure that we can alleviate the impacts on business. Firstly, when it comes to any regulatory issues, and the first of those is occupational health and safety regulations. The Attorney General is leading a process with the states and territories, which we anticipate being concluded in time for National Cabinet on Thursday, which will remove any suggestion of a requirement that small, medium-sized businesses have to be undertaking testing of their staff. There is some confusion about that. I should note, in pretty much all states, except possibly for Western Australia, there are no exposure sites anymore. And so the risk of a business becoming an exposure site is not something that they, as they were concerned about earlier in the year. That is now changed because of the definition of close contacts and the like. So working out those occupational health and safety regulations and giving small business certainty around that is very, very important. We identified this issue last week, and so that work is being done. Secondly, while large businesses in critical supply chains like Coles and Woolies and so on have the means to be able to support the arrangements that are set out in the medical expert paper about how their close contacts are managed in their centres, there are small and medium-sized businesses in the supply chain, in those critical supply chains, which won't have necessarily those resources. And yesterday I tasked Minister Robert with Minister Andrews to be working with those small businesses in those particular sectors about how we can support them more effectively together with states and territories to ensure that they can be taking up these new arrangements that are set out by the medical expert panel. We've also, the Treasurer, despite having COVID, he is still battling on. He's improving. I speak to him very regularly, and he's been speaking to the banks as well to be monitoring what the impact is on their customer base, on their small businesses. And the reports we're getting back are that while this is a tough time, and it is really tough for businesses because of the impact of COVID, that's living with COVID when there are a high number of cases is difficult. But what we are seeing is there are strong balance sheets right across the economy. And that is backed up by the data from APRA that the Treasurer has referred to today. And this is in the household sector, but we've got 45 months on average ahead of monthly mortgage repayments as of October of last year. Now that's up from 32 months. In September of last year, there was $222 billion on mortgage in mortgage offset accounts, and that's up from $174 billion in March 2020. So Australians have been making good decisions to increase their financial resilience during the course of this pandemic. They're using their smarts, they're making their choices, they're ensuring they're getting their financial position and is in a stronger position it can be to get through this pandemic. That's obviously been massively supported by everything from JobKeeper to Commonwealth disaster payments during the lockdowns that occurred, and these have been used well to strengthen people's resilience. And small businesses have had similar supports, but they're obviously dealing with the challenge of reduced consumer activity at the moment because of the Omicron variant. Now, the final issue I was going to raise before passing on to the Chief Medical Officer is our real focus, in addition to those other critical supply areas on Thursday, is going to be on schools. The Secretary of the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet, Secretary Gaitchens, has been working with all of the other states and territories to harmonise their back-to-school plans. Remember, as I said last week, our objective is go back, stay back, day one, term one. Now, the peak of the Omicron virus is going to be different in different states and territories. It's clearly going to peak in New South Wales and Victoria versus other states. And so states and territories will obviously work that through, and I'll ask the CMO to talk more about that. So the idea is once we go back, we stay back, and we get certainty around that issue. And so we'll be working through those issues this week and to get further certainty and harmonisation between the states and territories. And I thank all of them for working with us on that process. It's obviously a key issue for parents as they are thinking about their children going back to school in a few weeks' time. And we look to have those arrangements very clear by the time that occurs. And